Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to Christchurch Cathedral this evening for the last of our 2022 grand organ recitals. It gives me great pleasure to perform for you this evening a new work written this year by Philip Moore, who wrote the music, and David Broadbridge, who wrote the poetry, a new sequence of music and words which reflects the journey from Advent through to Christmas. This work presents the universal message of the birth of Jesus in a new guise, offering a richly imaginative resource of poems and organ music. Nativitas comprises a sequence of 9 poems exploring seasonal themes and using a variety of forms in the music, such as vianelle, ballad, and free verse. Each reading of poetry is enhanced by the organ music, reflecting the mood and imagery of the words. I'm delighted that the composer of tonight's piece will be joining us through the live stream, and I thought it appropriate that I read his words on the music you're about to hear. Philip Moore writes, "In writing these reflections on David Broadbridge's inspired words, I was struck once again how much the Nativity is the story of journeys. The journey of the 3 kings is the most obvious one, but there is also the journey of the shepherds, the journey made by Mary and Joseph, and the journey of a child opening an Advent calendar. The journey of childbirth from conception to birth is perhaps the most extraordinary of all. There is too our own journey through life, for which many has a spiritual element, whatever our beliefs may be. I have tried to reflect the journeys illustrated in the poems. Some of the musical gestures are obvious, such as the falling phrases in Adam's Fall. In Advent Calendar, I have tried to illustrate a child's impatience. The ground bass in I Hear a Baby's Cry suggests preparation for travel. And the fugue in the Ballad of Mary and Joseph is a musical illustration of progress from darkness and isolation to one of final fulfillment. Simeon with the Christ child is perhaps the end of the first part of Christ's life on earth. Basing the musical ideas on Stanford's immortal setting in G of the Nunc Dimittis seemed an appropriate way to anchor the listener into something familiar. Musically, all of the movements, apart from the last, are based on ideas in the first movement. Each movement starts on a note a semitone higher than the previous one. I'm delighted that this evening I'm joined by the author of tonight's poetry, David Broadbridge, and he's going to speak to you briefly about the poetry. But it's a true joy to be able to bring this work to life on the Rieger organ, and I believe is one of the first performances of this piece. So I do hope you enjoy, and I will hand over to David to talk you through some of the poetry.
The events leading up to Christmas and the story of Christmas itself are very well known. They have been celebrated in music, art, and literature over many centuries, indeed millennia. Presenting a new sequence of poems on this theme requires a degree of humility, not least because so much is so familiar. How to make this new? I have tried to make the poems windows through which to see the mystery and joy of Christmas. I also wanted to keep the language as simple and direct as possible. A message as transcendental as this needs no complications of meaning or difficulty of understanding. The search. though I had searched so hard all night to find it. Of the Nativity, I could find no earthly trace, and did not know how much that I would mind it. Should I have made my quest more open-minded, and not abandoned hope with such bad grace, since I had searched so hard all night to find it? The shepherds too, by travelling light, defined it by the angels' shining brightness in their face, though they had searched so hard all night to find it. The wise men, with their wisdom shelved, aligned it with a star, which led them to a stable place. They did not know how much they would mind it. All night, I longed to be a child, love blinded at the sight, the door ajar, my mouth agape, like one who did not think that he would find it. I should have thought instead what lay behind it, that seeking is the way to saving grace, though I had searched so hard all night to find it, and had not known how much that I would mind it. Advent calendar. As a child, my first lesson in patience was the Advent calendar. Even though I knew what I was waiting for, I longed to open every window all at once. But day after day, the scenes made no sense. Anticipation gave way to doubt. The early windows opened onto stacks of boxes tied with bows, a robin on a snow-flossed branch, a stagecoach on a country road. One window framed a reindeer with a red rouged nose. But as I counted down the days, I saw some angels standing by, a shepherd with a newborn lamb, a wise man with a gift of gold. And when, at last, the final morning came, I saw the Christmas story as of old. My calendared days opened on a star, a manger, and the child foretold. Adam's fall. Oh, what a price that Adam paid when from the tree of paradise he ate the fruit to make him wise. You cannot have a lodging here. You cannot have a lodging here. When Eve had plucked that apple tree, no more in Eden could they dwell. And far from God they headlong fell. You cannot have a lodging here. You cannot have a lodging here. No more in Eden could we dwell until the second Adam came to bring us to our rightful home. Then we shall have a lodging there. Then we shall have a lodging there. The Annunciation. It must have been a revelation when the old masters first imagined this. They knew how what you paint comes true, for here is both the story and its proof. The sky is painted a deep indigo, Giotto's heavenly shade of blue. Above a fleece of clouds, a dove descends, while cherub cheeks puff out in trumpet praise. Gabriel stands almost aside. His palms are open and upheld to bless. Mary kneels, looking up, a lily sprung from Hera's milk in hand. See how the artists show her face. They know the world conceives this miracle as well. What God can do, faith can believe. Her face has all the strength of tenderness. Faith in waiting. And how should I keep faith in waiting? But with the trust where promises begin. For the Christ child the world has longed to greet. I should count down the days of waiting until I find outside a starlit inn a mother with her firstborn son asleep. My gift, the faith I kept in waiting, as Mary kept the angel's news within, as shepherds did the Christ child then to meet. Then I would show my faith in waiting, and like a wise man, gladly enter in to worship at his tiny, tiny feet. The Ballad of Mary and Joseph. Pray tarry with me here this night, of all nights of the year. Our journey now is at its end, and I would have you near. The time has come, the hour is nigh, this night of all the year. Now spread this cloth upon the ground, I feel the child is near. The night is cold, the wind does blow, and one bright star does shine. I pray you fetch some water here, for now has come the time. I pray you fetch some water now, and fetch us bread and wine, that we may celebrate this hour for all of future time. Methought that as she spoke these words, an angel spread its wings, as if a dream had come to her of what the child would bring. I pray you tarry now with me, I fear some danger here. What if the babe should lie cold this night of all the year? I pray you fetch some water now, I pray you fetch some straw, that we may lie in safety here, but do not bar the door. The night is cold, the wind does blow, and one bright star does shine. Then Joseph came to where she lay with water, bread, and wine. He entered in the stable door and heard the child cry. There Mary lay upon the cloth, a tear within each eye. The Lord of light and life is born this night of all the year. The child you see before you now is God's own child and dear. So tarry with me here this night of all nights of the year. Our journey now is at its end. I bid you have good cheer. I hear a baby's cry. Thousands of miles away, I see panniers and provisions prepared. Camels saddled and watered. Doubt and curiosity in the air. Nearer, but just as far, farms and flocks hunch under frost, and in the ruck and rustle of stalled cattle, I hear a baby's cry. Time is paused and poised, as though shepherds were about to come. And a star was holding its course for here. O magnum mysterium. That animals should be the first to see a baby in their manger laid would not to them seem strange. They would be unsurprised at what was second nature to their lives, the labored birth, the push for life, the first breath's cry, the skeins of blood that streaked the straw. But they were surely taken by surprise when a lifted latch of widening light brought star-struck faces in from shines, or after days of growing quiet had passed, they smelt sweet spices in the raftered air and met the mild interrogation of distant eyes. They must have shifted in their stalls, their breath like gossip rising everywhere, and thought it odd, not that a baby had been born. They'd seen it all before and took him as they found him, nothing minding. But that strange kings and shepherds came, who told them of an angel and a star, and that the child they called the Christ was worth the finding.
Thank you.
Simeon with the Christ child. Yes, but is always the language of doubt. But here, there is no doubt. Righteous Simeon holds in his hands his faith. His arms are joists of prayer. He knows that his Redeemer lives. And through the almost dark of death, faith's ecstatic whisper says, "But yes."